Everybody, it's Ted DiBiase, the Million Dollar Man, and you're listening to the Wrestle Talk Podcast.
And out in the night out, you're tuning into Wrestle Talk. 657-383-1521. We'll be discussing WWE, NXT, Lucha Underground, ROH, Fantasy Wrestling, and we have some of the best damn interviews for professional and independent wrestling that you've ever heard.
And I'm Joe Lance. Ladies and gentlemen, buckle your seatbelts.
Canada, baby!
At all times.
And USA and mi querido Mexico, of course. What up, Nate? Big Nate the Shaw, baby. STL Zone. Yo, share this thing for you, boy, man. You know what to do. You know what to do.
Enjoy the ride.
What is up, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages? Nightmare Jones here. Wednesday night, 8 o'clock Eastern Time. That means one thing and one thing only. It is time for the Wrestle Talk Podcast. If you are listening to the sound of my voice, you have made a great choice, my friend, a great choice. We promise you that you would not regret it. My goodness gracious, do we have a show coming on tonight. We've got the Shoot and Shout segment, the High Spot segment. We've got the FWWC. We've got Snippets of Truth of Big Daddy P. Oh my goodness. We've got the Wrestle Talk Podcast Game Show Challenge. And if that's not enough, we have Greg Jovi coming on, as well as Maddog. And if that's not enough, tomorrow, actually, to be honest, in a couple of hours, Wrestle Kingdom happens. I cannot tell you how excited I am for Wrestle Kingdom, but I know someone that's a little bit more excited than I am. That is the man, the myth, the legend, the Night Owl. What's going on, my friend?
What is up, Nightmare Jones? Que pasa, que pasa, que pasa? Beloved members of the Wrestle Talk family. Nightmare, I am excited, but man, I gotta hit you early in the show with this. Dude, it's Greg Jovi. Greg Jovi. Say it with me. Greg Jovi. Shout out. Go ahead, buddy.
It was my bad, Greg Jovi. I saw it, and the first thing I saw was immediately John Bon Jovi.
So oh, you saw Jovi. Bro, I'm sure you're not the first person or the last person to ever make the mistake. Yo, what's up, Rachel? What up, Kyle? Shelly? What up, Brandon? What up, Nathan? And everybody else that's tuning in right now live on the Facebook live feed. For those who are listening on replay, we love you just the same. Make sure that you give us a rating. Make sure that you share this broadcast. That is all that we will ever ask from you. And shout out to everybody checking us out in Philly. Much love to you. Shout out to my man, Sonny Mayo. It's going to be a tremendous show. Joe, you've already kind of recapped today's show. What you did mention, though, man, is that we got the Fantasy Wrestling Worldwide chapter right after the first hour, about 10 minutes of the world's greatest fantasy wrestling group. We're going to have some people on. I know that there's going to be some scores revealed today, so everybody who tunes in for the FWWC, don't worry. We will not disappoint you. We will have some breaking news for you, but man, before we get there, bro, we got the Mad Dog, we got Greg Jovi, but we also got High Spots, Nightmare Jones, and I'm pretty excited because, like you said, we're getting ready for Wrestle Kingdom. The magazines, ESPN, Rolling Stone, and SI, dude, they all released kind of their Wrestler of the Year. We're going to get into all that, but you know, Joe, before we get into all that, I got to ask you one question, man. How the hell have you been lately, bro?
I have been good. I finally got over this cold that I had, and it was a good New Year's, and things have been good. Now, Rene, I know that with me, you're going to watch the entire Wrestle Kingdom tonight, right?
I'm
going to 2 o'clock in the morning. I know you're going to watch the entire thing just like I am.
Dude, absolutely. And you know what, man? I got everybody. Shout out to Jeff Wilson. Shout out to Eric. You guys probably saw the story that we shared about Brian Pillman Jr. on the Wrestle Talk podcast fan page. If you didn't, what are you doing with your life? Why are you not checking out the Wrestle Talk podcast fan page? I'll tell you what, Joe. I'm going to do my best to watch all of New Japan Pro Wrestling. You know, they don't call me the night owl for no reason. I don't usually get a whole lot of sleep. But what I am going to try to do is take a quick nap after the show. Wake up about 1 a.m., crack open a couple of cold ones, and sit down for about 5 hours and try to catch the whole show, man. That is my goal. I make no promises, but I'll tell you what, we will discuss it at length next week right here on the Wrestle Talk podcast, man. Episode 176 tonight and 177 next week, baby. We are on the road to 200 episodes. But, Joe, there's something we do every single time here on the Wrestle Talk podcast. We've done it for 176 episodes, and we can't do it. We can't move forward with today before we do it. You know what that is, right, Nightmare Jones?
I believe it has to do with the Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, maybe? That's right. That's right. Our buddy, touted vocalist Carl Lewis, with his rendition of the Star Spangled Banner. So we ask all you guys to kindly remove your caps. Place your hands over your hearts as we pay homage to the greatest country on God's green earth. And that's America, damn it.
Oh, oh, say, can you see? And the rock is red. I'll make it for now. For the land of the free.
Please.
Need to turn my eye every single time.
Please don't do that, Joe.
Lewis.
Please don't do that. And you know what? We're getting ready to get into high spots, and we're going to be joined by none other than Dynamo Pro Wrestling's very own Luke Roberts. So, intern Timmy, go ahead and crank up that high spots music, baby. Let's get right into the show.
Speaking Earthlings, we have now taken over your radio.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for the High Spot segment. But before we get into that, let me go ahead and bring in the man, the myth, the legend, Dynamo Pro's own Mr. Luke Roberts. Hello, Luke Roberts. How are you today, sir?
Well, Mr. Lance, I think we got some breaking news here. Just as I said, I know I'm always welcome here on the Wrestle Talk podcast, but are we starting things off with some breaking news here today?
That's right, Luke Roberts. We do have some breaking news, and before we officially welcome you on, there is some breaking news from Dynamo Pro Wrestling. And the news that we heard through the grapevine is that in late October 2017, just a couple of months ago, due to his numerous international wrestling commitments, the unbreakable Michael Elgin relinquished the Dynamo Pro Wrestling D1 Championship. After much discussion, Dynamo Pro Wrestling management has chosen to begin the process of crowning a new Dynamo Pro Wrestling D1 Champion. Over the course of the next 3 Dynamo Pro Wrestling events, there will be 6 qualifying matches. And the winners of these matches will move on until it says that will be competing in some sort of six-man scramble with a ladder match? Listen, I know we got a lot to talk about concerning New Japan and all things pro wrestling, but Luke, give us a skinny. You're right there. You're next to Jim and Crystal in the office, in the Dynamo Pro offices. Man, what in the heck is going on with the D1 championship?
Well, Rene, Joe, you know firsthand the Dynamo Pro D1 championship is one of the most prestigious championships in Dynamo Pro Wrestling. And near the end of October, Michael Elgin, I mean, again, as we know, you were mentioning it earlier. He is overseas right now as we speak, getting prepared for a matchup tonight, or actually tomorrow morning, as Joe said, because of that wonderful time change deal with Wrestle Kingdom over at the Tokyo Dome. But I know that the man is in high demand all across this planet. He's part of Wrestle Kingdom. He's regularly with the World Tag League. He's part of the Climax, G1 Climax tournament. He's made some journeys down to the CMLL promotion in Japan or in Mexico. And the end result was back in October, he made the decision to relinquish the Dynamo Pro D1 championship back to Dynamo Pro Management. And Dynamo Pro Management went out and decided that it's 2018, we're going to start the year off right, we're going to have qualifying matches to get our six qualifiers. I mean, Dynamo Pro D1 title has always been about thinking outside the box. I mean, the first time we crowned the inaugural D1 champion, it was Elvis Aliaga, Jaden Phoenix, and Outcast, all three men winning six-man scramble matches to get into the three-way finals, and Outcast walking out with the inaugural.
Yo, what up, baller? Thanks for checking us out, bro. Appreciate you being here. Thanks for all the love, man.
Matches over the course of the next three Dynamo Pro events leading to, and you said it right, Rene, a six-man scramble ladder match to crown a new Dynamo Pro D1 champion. I'm going to tell you right now, anybody that's been following Dynamo Pro, there are a lot of guys who very well could step up and be considered strong contenders for that championship. I mean, you've got former Dynamo Pro Heavyweight Champion Brandon Aarons. You've got lights out Adrian Surgeman, who made huge impact in 2017. But there's a lot of wrestlers, too, that very well may kind of be the wild cards, if you will. Wrestlers like DJ Shine, wrestlers like Jaden Roller. I got to say this, and I know my broadcast colleague Chris Rovell is probably going to be scratching his head when he hears this. This type of a format to qualify may be something up the alley of the snitch. I mean, again, this series of matches to crown a new D1 champion is definitely going to give as many people as possible an opportunity to grab that brass ring, if you will, and become the new D1 champion. And I got to say, it's something that myself, Chris Rodell, my broadcast colleague Patrick Brandmeier, among others, have sat down and talked about. And much like Wrestle Kingdom, and we're going to talk a lot more about things going on with High Spot, while a lot of great wrestlers who can step up, you got basically right now, who knows who's going to wind up walking out in the upcoming weeks with that D1 championship.
So you're telling me that the greatest wrestler in Dynamo Pro, Ozzy Gallagher, could win the D1 championship?
You never know, Joe. I mean, again, there's a lot of wrestlers who said, I mean, literally, New Year's, the announcement's made, and I'm not kidding. I mean, it's literally, I go to lunch, and there's wrestlers coming in wanting to put their names on contract. I come back from lunch, there's wrestlers wanting to put their names on contract. I'm not kidding. I had wrestlers walk into the office 30 minutes ago getting prepared for tonight's High Spot segment, trying everything they can to get one of those very coveted spots. And I'm going to tell you, once those competitors are announced, I mean, you're going to be very surprised. And I think the Dynamo Pro Wrestling fans are going to be looking forward to a great series of matches to crown a new Dynamo Pro D1 champion.
Well, you know what? That's pretty exciting.
Exactly.
Well, hey, Joe, sorry to jump in here. I just wanted to say this, man. A six-man scramble on a ladder for the new D1 champion, there's only one way to describe that.
Oh my God!
Joey Styles never lets me down, no doubt about it. Hey, we even got people petitioning for Lucy Mendez to be your first ever D1 champion. I guess you guys will have to tune in to Dynamo Pro Wrestling to find out who's actually going to be in these qualifying matches. I'm pretty excited about it. But before we move on from Dynamo Pro, I had one last question for you, Luke, because I know we got a bunch of people on hold excited to get on and talk all facets of pro wrestling here on the High Spots segment on the Wrestle Talk podcast with Joe and Rene. But I have been monitoring Twitter pretty closely, and it seems like a gentleman by the name of The Snitch has a huge problem with Dynamo Pro management. Do you care to maybe comment on some of the accusations that The Snitch has been slinging on social media?
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I mean, again, being media relations director of Dynamo Pro Wrestling, I kind of keep an eye on everybody, but I'm going to tell you right now, The Snitch has gone out as of late, and I trying to be as impartial as I can, I got to say that he's trying to make a statement. I mean, again, when you look at it, he goes out there, goes out at the Four Hands event, Spear, Food, and Body Slam, gets in the Battle Royal, winds up being one of the final two wrestlers. I mean, again, he had a great strategy. Granted, he hit behind myself and Chris Rodell for most of the match, but he's never thrown over the top. Then he goes out and he makes comments. He has a matchup with Tony Esteem. He kind of branches out a little bit into the tag team division. He wrestles against Savannah Stone a few weeks ago. Our last event wrestled former T1 champion Outcast. I mean, here's a guy who feels in his mind he's been slighted, he's been neglected. There's been a lot of choice hashtags that he's chosen to put out there. But I mean, right now, to me, Rene, I think it's one of those things where they're going to be, to me, The Snitch has improved greatly over the last few months. This isn't his first dance. He's gained a lot of experience in Dynamo Pro. And I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know where or when, but eventually I think that people are definitely going to need to keep an eye out for The Snitch, because he's a man, there's not a lot known about him. Don't really see him come in and out of locker rooms. I mean, he's kind of literally the cover of darkness as his friend. I'm going to tell you right now, when he finally puts all the pieces together, he's going to be a very equal threat in Dynamo Pro.
Okay, well, we appreciate you addressing the situation, because he's definitely making a lot of waves. That said, Joe, I know there are quite a few topics that we need to get into during the High Spot segment, so I want to encourage everyone who's tuning in to dial that number. That number being 657-383-1521. Again, that's 657-383-1521. And, of course, a very special shout-out to Big Daddy P, who's on the recovery tip. He was in the hospital just a few days ago. We're hoping he can make his presence felt tonight. Either way, we're going to have a prayer segment with or without him, but he is on our minds, in our hearts, and in our prayers. And then also, if you guys are wondering why I'm wearing the Canada bandana, that's also in honor of one of our friends that is on the shelf for a short while, Danny Duggan, one of our wonderful sponsors over at Canadian Wrestling Elite, CWE, also was recently injured on his, I think he's doing like a 12 or 16-day tour alongside no one, maybe just a guy named Jake the Snake Roberts, and a guy named Kevin Lee Davidson that was here on the show a couple of weeks ago. And then, of course, big prayers to our friend Larry Madison over at SICW. So with that said, Nightmare Jones, what are we talking about on High Spots tonight, man?
So before we get into High Spots, here is something that I just found that is absolutely amazing. Fans around the independent wrestling circuit are giving a lukewarm reception to the new team of Too Cold Scorpio and Scotty Too Hotty, known as Room Temperature. That's right, Scotty Too Hotty and Too Cold Scorpio have decided to start a tag team called Room Temperature. What do you think about that, Rene?
You're kidding me, right?
kayfabe news.
Oh my goodness. Hey, listen, I call shenanigans on the kayfabe news. Can we get on to some real news now, Joe? You're killing me over here.
Well, Yeah.
That was pretty good, though.
Yes, we room, absolutely.
Would you say they were? Yeah, they're calling themselves room temperature.
Yes, room temperature. No, after watching SmackDown this past couple weeks, what the heck has been going on with Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon? Are we seeing a Daniel Bryan maybe heel turn? I mean, he put AJ Styles in a handicap match at the Royal Rumble against Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn. That's just, what the heck is going on? That's just crazy. What are your thoughts about that, Rene?
You know what? That is an interesting question, and honestly, I have no idea. What I can tell you is that no matter what it takes, I want to see Daniel Bryan back in a wrestling ring if his health permits it. How they're going about doing this, I don't like it. I think the match is a terrible idea. I just don't see it working. Obviously, the angle is going to be, you know, the idea is to try to get Kevin and Sammy to turn against each other. And in that way, you're kind of giving AJ an ability to kind of stay in front of the two guys instead of having one on the outside, one on the inside. But the way that SmackDown ended, honestly, it didn't go too well. It didn't go over too well, at least with me. But I am excited to see what happens in the future. I'm curious to hear what Luke thinks.
Well, gentlemen, I got to tell you right now, when I'm looking at the whole situation with Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon, I go back to the last event, the last major event. Shane McMahon blatantly would not count the three. Daniel Bryan comes in, counts the three count. I got to say, I know a lot of people are going to disagree with me on this, but you got to look at it from the point of view. Daniel Bryan did his job as an official. And again, Joe, I know you could agree with me here from having been in the Sprites a time or two. You know, the official job is to maintain law and order inside the ring, and the three count has to take place. Can I see Shane McMahon's point of view? Yeah, he's the man in charge. He's calling the shot. But when you look at Daniel Bryan, I mean, here's a man, his credentials speak for themselves, and I throw it this way, and Renee, you may kind of be shocked a little bit at this. Remember a little thing called Lay Cool? And the fact that two women wound up having, I believe, kind of the Divas champ or the Women's Championship, to me, I agree in the fact that you have eyes on both your men. It's got to be a one-on-one contest. But what happens if they win? Are you going to actually have co-WWE champions? I mean, it's not out of the realm of possibility. You have Lay Cool. You also have the late China and Y2J. The Alpha we're talking about later on, Chris Jericho, who were co-Intercontinental Champions. Can it happen? Yes, and I'm going to tell you right now, with the momentum that Zayn and Cena are, Owens are on, I got to get things bigger, Kevin Owens,
flashback.
Right now as it stands, these two gentlemen, the momentum they're on, you very well could see, and I guess that would be the way it would go, co-WWE Champions if they're successful at the Royal Rumble, and I wouldn't necessarily discredit them.
All right, well, that's fair. I appreciate it. That was a great topic to bring up, Joe. I know there's a couple other things we wanted to cover on High Spots today, man. What do we have up next? Okay, oh, apparently Joe is screening some callers, which I think is a great thing. Let me go ahead and toss it on out, just because I do have the notes in front of me. Luke, obviously, 2017 was a wonderful year for professional wrestling. It continues to grow. It continues to evolve. But with a great year comes some controversy. And right towards the end of the year, three extremely well-known publications put out what we would call Wrestler of the Year. They all call it something different, but in essence, it's all kind of the same thing. So for those who don't know, ESPN named AJ Styles Wrestler of the Year. Sports Illustrated named Kenny Omega Wrestler of the Year. And Rolling Stone named The Miz Wrestler of the Year. I know all three of us have a different opinion on this, but I'll go ahead and let you go first. Luke, who do you truly believe of these three was the 2017 Wrestler of the Year?
Well, you know, I'm going to throw the other wild card in here too, Rene. I know we talked about in the past episode of High Spot. You also forgot Pro Wrestling Illustrated naming Kushida Okada Wrestler of the Year 500. So I mean, you're looking at it. There's a lot of people who feel a lot of different ways, and I mean, a lot of wrestlers can go out there. And I just look at it right now. The Miz pretty much having a stranglehold on the IC Championship and making it must-see television. You have AJ Styles and his journey to the WWE title. You have, and again, just two gentlemen who are going to be in the marquee matchup at Wrestle Kingdom. Okada, and you have Kenny Omega. To me, I mean, there's a lot of things there. I've got to say right now, based on what's there, to me, in a very close decision, I would probably go with AJ Styles as Wrestler of the Year just barely because of the idea. I mean, again, he was consistently in those high-profile matchups, not just for the WWE Championship. You've also got to look at his matchups with Kevin Owens. I mean, when you sit there and look at it, this man has been consistently in the top of the lineup, multiple championships, I mean, multiple main event-level matchups. To me, I got to say that AJ Styles, Sky Sports is another one I looked at that said AJ Styles, Wrestler of the Year. I got to say, in a very close thought to me, AJ Styles and Sylvia.
Well, you know what? Not a bad choice. Not a bad choice. I don't know if I necessarily agree, but let's hear what Nightmare Jones thinks about this. Joe, you've heard it. PWI picked Okada. ESPN picked AJ. SI picked Kenny, and Rolling Stone picked The Miz. Who do you think was the 2017 Wrestler of the Year?
You know, they're all great, great wrestlers, and they all had a great, great year. For me, I would go ahead and go with The Miz. I think that The Miz has had a wonderful program since gaining the Intercontinental Championship. He had a great feud with Dean Ambrose. I feel that this was the Miz's year. Like, he kept everything entertaining. Like, he was one of these guys where every time he defended his belt, you wanted him to lose that belt. And every time he would find a way. And I just feel that the Miz should be the wrestler of the year. That's just my opinion.
Well, you know what, Joe? Strong opinion from you. I mean, you and Luke are definitely on the right track as far as I'm concerned. But unfortunately, you're both wrong. You know, because there's only one Wrestler of the Year, and he is part of the elite, the elite, the elite, the elite. Picture this, ladies and gentlemen. For the first time ever, you have, well, let's just say in recent history, the last maybe 25 or 30 years, you have a WWE Hall of Famer who is still directly associated with the company that is going to be co-main eventing Wrestle Kingdom 12. Why? He's not going over there to wrestle Okada. He's not going over there to wrestle Naito. No, he's going over there to wrestle one man, and that is the cleaner, Kenny effing Omega. Nobody has been hotter since this time last year. One of the matches that has been considered one of the greatest matches in wrestling history by many people, much more knowledgeable than yours truly, in the match that he had last year against Okada. That's right, the cleaner Kenny Omega has revolutionized the way we look at professional wrestling. He has brought over a WWE Hall of Famer to wrestle in a Wrestle Kingdom event. And he is almost single-handedly helping Japan make their invasion of the United States wrestling market. And his second in command happens to be the son of Dusty Rhodes. Cody Rhodes was so impressed with Bullet Club and Kenny Omega that he went to be a Kenny Omega underling. I know a lot of people will argue with me, well, Cody's the real leader of the Bullet Club. Shit, quiet. Quiet, quiet, quiet. There's no arguing, okay? Kenny Omega, without a shadow of a doubt, 2017 Wrestler of the Year. Oh, did I mention that he won the G1 and is the first ever United States champion for New Japan Pro Wrestling? Oh, I'm sorry. I almost forgot that part. Guys, I love your arguments. You came real strong. But unfortunately, you're leaving with second and third place because the cleaner is numero uno, and there's no arguing that point. I'm sorry. Try again next time.
Well, Rene, I'm gonna jump in here right here. Number one, you got to remember, he was the winner of the G1 last year. If you remember who wound up winning it this year, it was Naito. It was not Kenny Omega who won it in 2017. And when you look at it, though, I can agree with you to that point. And again, he basically single-handedly gone out and made a huge statement. But another thing that you got to look at, and I've had the opportunity to listen to some very colorful interviews and press conference footage and vignettes and all these things. Chris Jericho is not coming for a wrestling match. As Kenny Omega said at a press at one of the Wrestle Kingdom press conferences, he was hoping for a gentlemanly contest. Chris Jericho is coming for a fight. Chris Jericho is coming to end the career of Kenny Omega. And I mean, Chris Jericho's reputation, as you said, future WWE Hall of Famer, the man has pretty much done it all in professional wrestling. I'm going to tell you right now, in just a few hours at Wrestle Kingdom, Kenny Omega and Chris Jericho are going to have a matchup that I'm going to tell you, neither man is going to be the same, but I'm also going to go on record right now and I'm going to say flat out, because I think this match, pardon me, along with Naito and Okada, are going to change not only a lot of the Japanese wrestling fans' perception of New Japan, but I think they're going to change the way people look at professional wrestling after WrestleMania tonight.
No doubt about it. And let me tell you something. There's only one guy that could brought Chris Jericho from the top of the charts and WWE over to Wrestle Kingdom 12, and that is the cleaner, Kenny Omega, the elite. Listen, guys, as much as I've enjoyed this conversation, I think we could probably keep going and going and going. We have a special guest ready to come on. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. PWCS's very own Greg Jovi is going to join us here momentarily. Luke Roberts, you're more than welcome to stay and hang out with us and be a part of the remainder of the show. If you would prefer to come back a little bit later, that's cool. You let us know what you want to do, but we got to move forward.
Well, not a problem. Like I said, I'm going to tell you one thing before we go to Greg Jovi, the owner of the Eagle Busters of PWCS. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to sit and listen in because, as you forgot to mention earlier on, I'm going to kind of have a little bit of a moment of reflection after the sinister attack that we saw this past weekend on ROH television regarding Daryl taking, I believe, a Meltzer driver from the Young Bucks. Definitely something that's bothering me very deeply. I'm going to make sure to listen to the program. Like I said, we've got PWCS, we've got Maddog McDowell coming on in the second hour. Guys, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to sit back and watch, listen to the show, and like you guys said, get ready for tonight. Usually we talk about NXT. Tonight is Wrestle Kingdom, and it's going to be a great Wrestle Talk podcast and Wrestle Kingdom. We're going to have a lot to talk about next week. Gentlemen, I will be talking with you soon.
All right, Luke Roberts. Much love to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Luke Roberts, Media Relations Director for Dynamo Pro Wrestling. Yeah, hey, you know that joke. You know the Wrestle Talk family absolutely loves Luke Roberts. But you know who they're going to learn to love? They're going to learn to love this next gentleman that is going to be joining us on the show. You heard us talk about him a little bit. I've seen him here in Kansas City under an assumed name, but he is also very well known in Southern Illinois and in St. Louis as the owner of the Ego Busters. That's right. PCWS has got a huge show coming up. It's called the Mega Ticket on January 6th, just 3 days away. And I said to myself, hey, we got to get a representation from PCWS on the show. It's been far too long. And who better than the man himself, Greg Jovi, to join us. Intern Timmy, I know you got some music you got to cue up, baby. Go ahead and hit that music. And let's bring in the man himself, Greg Jovi.
Oh,
Hi, welcome to the show, sir.
Hey, guys, how you doing?
Woo! Doing great, buddy. How are you?
Good. How's things been going with you, sir?
Oh, fantastic, man. We're barreling right down the road to the mega ticket here for PWCS. It's our big end of year, almost like the Super Bowl for us. And as Rene mentioned earlier, I mean, I've been doing a lot of great work up in Kansas City, so I'd love to come on and talk about all of it. And it's great to be here, guys.
Oh, that's awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So how did you get involved in PWCS?
So me and a buddy of mine are actually the co-owners of the program. So we started about four. This will be our fourth season finale. So we've done four full run through of the season. And for those of you guys that don't know a little bit about what we do it a little bit differently at PWCS. We do a team pro wrestling as a team sport. So you can think it almost like fight camps in MMA, and those wrestlers they take that win or loss for their team, and at the end of the season, the two teams with the best records face off in a big 4-on-4 elimination match, and that's what we're barreling towards here this Saturday, the 6th. My team, the Eagle Busters, have an unprecedented 11-2 record this year, are going up against the Submission Squad, who they snuck in on a tiebreaker at the very last event, and they're going to try and go down and knock down us. We're the defending champs. So they're going to try and take us down this season, and we'll see if they can do it this Saturday night.
Absolutely. So, in addition to the matchup between the Ego Busters and the Submission Squad, you also have the Miracle Worker David Vega defending his Gateway Heritage Championship against the Dirty Rook, Matt Vincent, in a match that has been 1 year in the making. How did that match come about?
So last year at the we do a big tournament show every year called the FTLI. It's kind of like our off-season event, sort of reset things before the next season. And we never had a singles champion before. We always were pushing the team concept. And when Matt Jackson had to close up STL Anarchy to go up and start on the project that was the NWL this time last year, he gave us the Anarchy belt and said that he wanted us to run in their venue and carry on the lineage of their title. And so we renamed it the Gateway Heritage Championship to reflect all the great history of the St. Louis area. And we decided to have Davey Vega carry over as champion because he was the last Anarchy champion. And he won it that night from Matt Fitchett. So we decided, no better way than to have those two guys square off, the besties in the world, explode at last year's STLI, and in a big shocking finish, Vega cheated to win and continued to go. And Vega has said all year that it's not about who's friends, and it's not about, he doesn't hate Matt Fitchett, he doesn't respect him any less, but he's going to do whatever he's got to do to hang on to that belt. And Fitchett kind of knows the score now, so they're looking to go in and square up. And they got some bad blood to take care of and flesh out. And Vega's going to do everything he can to hold on to that belt. Matt Fitchett's going to do everything he can to get it back. So that's going to be a barn burner of a contest. That's really kind of the marquee match. We had originally had Jimmy Jacobs in, but due to a knee injury, he's not going to be able to show up. And so it's Vega and Fitchett's show. It's their time to show why they are the two best in this country. And they're going to do that Saturday night for that Gateway Heritage Championship.
Okay. Now, last question before I send it back to my co-host, Rene, because I don't want to take up all of the time. What does the matchup with the Ego Busters and the Submission Squad mean to Greg Jovi?
To me, I mean, the other people in the company bought that trophy and named it after my mother. I'm one of the people that obviously founded the company and thought up the concept. And so it means everything for me to continue to hold that trophy. I said from the beginning that my team would be a dynasty. We're supposed to be the Yankees of pro wrestling. We can't be the Yankees of pro wrestling if you don't win. And we finally won last year. It was kind of a shock. It was the first time there wasn't a big happy ending to the mega ticket event, and it kind of took people by surprise. Well, I'm not going to take anybody by surprise this year. So we're coming in, and we're going to square up with the submission squad, and they have a really great talented roster as well. But I don't think it's what you're looking at on the other side over there with Vega, Christian Rose, Adrian Surge, and what we bring to the table.
Okay. Rene, are you back with us?
Oh, dude, absolutely. I've been listening in, man.
All right,
and
Joe,
I'm here.
I would have to say that my next question would be, what do you hope that the fans get out of going to a PWCS show? Like, at the end of the show, what do you hope that the fans get out of going to one of your shows there?
When they come to a PWCS event, I hope they feel a part of it. It's something that you can't get on a bigger scale, and it's something that I have a fantastic time performing in NWL. And you see when there's a 500-600 deep crowd, that it's not the same as that intimate environment where you're right on top of the performers and you are literally shaping that show with your reactions and what you're doing. And so that's what I hope fans get out of it. I hope they realize that when they come in and they put down their ticket, they are supporting, helping each people that are involved with that, from the sound guy to the lady taking tickets, all the way up to the performers. They're supporting their dreams and what they're striving to do. They're striving to get to companies like NWL and beyond. And so, I hope that they get a sense of connection to the product that they don't get other places.
Well, allow me to jump in here, and I apologize, I was screening some callers and stuff, but we are good to go. Greg, dude, real excited to talk to you. I've seen you around at multiple shows over the last couple of years, but one show in particular comes to mind, and I think you'll remember it. It was here in Kansas City and Overland Park, and you were managing Maverick, the former STL champion for NWL, as he teamed with Dak Draper to face two true blue legends of professional wrestling. That's right, I'm talking about Meng and the Barbarian. Man, that must have been crazy, because I was right there in the front row giving you a hard time. And I gotta know, man, because I know you've been in wrestling for a long time, but I know you're also a huge fan. Okay, ACH told us last week, he's like, hey, wrestlers are the biggest marks, man. So I'm curious, what was that experience like for you, not only to be able to be there ringside, basically with the best seat in the house, but also to be like kind of backstage with these two legends?
Oh, dude, top five moment in everything that I've done. Absolutely. It was one of the coolest things I've ever got to do. And just like you said, we're the biggest marks, we're the biggest fans, and it's wild to have a group of friends over, and I'll just turn on something random on the network, and Ming and the Barbarian will pop up, and I'll be like, whoa, I performed with those guys. Like,
that's rad, dude.
It was a super honor, man. Like when we, when I saw it announced, I didn't know we were going to be doing that ahead of time. And I saw it the same time everybody else saw it on Instagram, and I started having people text me about it and everything. It was absolutely wild. It was an honor to perform with them. They are interesting characters, I'll say that.
Oh, dude, I'm telling you right now, you know, you think Maverick and Draper are big guys, and they are, but man, Meng was laying those chops in like there was no tomorrow, bro. And I was right there, and I filmed some of it on my cell phone, and I was just like, you know what, I've asked myself several times throughout my life whether or not I wanted to be a professional wrestler or not. And when I go to events like that and I hear a guy getting slapped across the chest, it's just a very true reminder of why I have no intentions of ever going up. Look, Meng was probably in his late 50s, early 60s. That dude could bench press a 300-pound man at his age if you wanted to. The guy is absolutely impressive, and it's almost like he's impervious to pain. And the Barbarian is just, well, he's a freaking barbarian, dude. It must have been insane for you to be there.
It's absolutely insane, especially being there with those giant guys. I mean, you talk about how you think he could do this, you think he could do that. He shoot pile drove Jack Draper. Against his will and pile drove.
Oh my goodness! That does, hey, that
you're gonna do what they you want to. So you're gonna do what they want you to do, man. There's no talking stuff. They were super cool though. Yeah, man, Mink's hands, the size of the hand was insane.
Yeah, that man's hands aren't hands. They're like freaking paws, dude. It's crazy. It is absolutely absolutely nuts. Well, let me jump over to this, and it was something that you kind of mentioned a little bit earlier. Feel free to answer this question how you would like to. But you said something that I think resonated with me, and I think that's the reason why I make the trip out to the STL, Southern Illinois area, a few times a year. And that is the environment of the shows there versus here. I've been very fortunate to go to many shows here in the Kansas City area. Some are better than others. But the St. Louis, Southern Illinois wrestling scene is something different. The fans there know what they're there for. They want to be packed in like a can of sardines. And that creates an aura. It creates a feeling when you go to a wrestling show that's hard to replicate with flashy lights or an awesome stage or whatever it may be. I'm curious, is there something to be said about a PWCS or an Anarchy or a Dynamo or companies like that that maybe don't put 500, 600 people in a building, but the show itself is just so absolutely extraordinary? Because I know you guys are running out of the Spalding Club, and the Spalding Club's got a pretty damn amazing history all on its own. So can you speak to that a little bit, being a guy that is kind of like in the epicenter of it all out in the St. Louis / Southern Illinois area?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think as far as the environment, I can equate it to the difference of like the back in the day when you would go to an ECW show versus going to a WWE show. It was something to where when you go to a WWE show, it's amazing. It's a big production. It's light. It's sound. It's a whole thing. As opposed to ECW was just feeling a part of something. When you went to an ECW show, you felt like you were, you know, somehow you buying that ticket and you screaming and yelling and you saying what you felt about the wrestlers was shaping that product moment by moment. And I think that's the difference in the environment. I think the difference in the crowds as well is palpable, because like you said, there's many different events in the Kansas City area, but I think there's many more here in this area. So while it's super fun to go and perform in that environment in Kansas City, because it's much more, they're much more accepting, I feel like, as opposed to St. Louis crowd, the Southern Illinois, St. Louis area, they may be a little less accepting. They may be a little less quick to jump on, but it's also super rewarding when you do get them and you do fully engage them, because you know, just like with an ECW fan or, you know, back in the day, you know that if you can get them hooked, then you've really done something good. And I think that's what I noticed, is that when we really, especially every mega ticket, we have had the people on their feet fighting in with the 4-on-4 elimination match. And so that's something that every year I go back and watch on tape and say, man, they got them. And they're, you know, it's super, it's like that girl it's hard to get, you know? Like this.
Right.
Like, man, you put in all that work and you brought them along all year, and now, man, you got them. Then they bought in, and it's super rewarding. Not that it's any more rewarding to get a reaction from a fan in Kansas City. It's just that it's different. It's a different way, a different vibe. Like you said, because you kind of felt both of them. With up there, I feel like they're super easy to catch on, because they want to come in, they want to have fun, and they're just easy. They're more easygoing fans, as opposed to down here, where they may be a little more harsh on something if it's not good or if it's not what they like, because they have so much product. But it makes it that much better that when you put out a, you know, top choice steak instead of a sirloin cut, and they let you know about it, then it makes it that much more rewarding.
No, absolutely. And that's exactly what I picked up on when I started going out there. My first show was a Dynamo show, and since then I've been to multiple other shows, including Glory. Not yet had the pleasure of going to a PWCS show, but I want to definitely make sure that I do that in 2018. I actually wanted to ask you about the upcoming show here on Saturday. which one of your main event matches is the Fitchett Vega match. As we all know, they travel the country as a tag team, the besties in the world, and at PWCS, they happen to be going against each other. I guess one, my question is, how do you keep guys like that coming back? I mean, you know, these guys are working all over the place. AAW, I could sit here and go on and on about everywhere that they've worked, but they're a hot commodity. So what is it about PWCS that keeps guys like them coming back? I mean, you've had Eric Cannon in the building. You guys, obviously, you know, you got Gary J from the Submission Squad that makes his way around the country all the way down to Atlanta and back. You've had Colt Cabana in the building. I mean, so you've got guys that could easily basically pick and choose where they want to work. And you guys, you know, you got Dominic Gardani, guys like that that are well known. And for whatever reason, they always make their way back. What is that PWCS has created that makes those guys loyal to you and makes them want to come back to your shows?
I think specifically speaking to Fitchett and Vega, they believe in the product. Gary J believes in the product. Those guys that you see that have been here since the Anarchy days, they've always believed, even when Anarchy was running and we were sort of competition, they've always believed in me and the product. And so they are willing to come here for, I'm sure we've never talked about it, but I'm sure less money and less exposure than they would for something like AAW and things like that. We obviously work to make sure that we're not going to make them choose, because that's not something we would ever want to do to them.
Right.
But you work your schedules around, and that's what keeps them coming back, is that they like that it's something different, they like that it's something new, and they get to feel like they're a big part of it.
Dude, that's awesome. And being able to create that environment is something that money cannot buy. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. Well, I know you were on hold, Greg, a little bit earlier, and you were listening to us talk about, you know, this absolutely huge show, the Wrestle Kingdom 12 show. And I'm curious, as busy as you are, do you make time still to sit down and watch wrestling? And if you do, what is it that you're watching these days?
I definitely am trying to get more into New Japan, because I've just started to really get it. I know that probably makes me sound super lame.
Dude, you're not the only one, man.
It's something where it's like, and it's not even just with the Bullet Club stuff. I literally watched something that was like, it was a series of videos on YouTube that explained that this is clear. This is what New Japan's all about, this type of product. Finally, then you go, oh, I get it. It's a little bit like what you're doing.
There's it is.
And, you know, that's what's cool. Is that, I mean, it's something, and you can't ignore it. I think that's my thoughts on Wrestle Kingdom, is that you can't ignore it now. You know, I went to a Sephora when I was out Christmas shopping, and I was embarrassed to be in there in my Bullet Club t-shirt, and the first lady working the counter said, oh man, too sweet, and threw up too sweet.
Like, that's awesome.
Cool again. Wrestling's cool again, you know? And that's what I like with that. I try to make time. I like watching, I definitely like watching things like, obviously, people that are, you know, in my area. I love AIW. I watch a lot of that out of Cleveland, and that's kind of how we got hooked into Dominic Verini and that cargo guy. And then I, like I said, I'm trying to get more into New Japan. And then I really like a lot right now, I'm just watching older stuff, just to learn different ways things were presented, different things, different ways you can kind of, you always look at history to how you want to present something in the future. So if you want ideas, you want to get the creative juices flowing, you know, go turn on a Nitro from 97 and see what the hell was going on.
Hell yeah.
I've been liking a lot, like, the listen-along podcasts that are coming out, like the What Happened When with Tony Schiavone, and you go back and listen to some of those shows from the 90s and things like that, and have fun with it, and it just gets you interested in watching things that maybe you wouldn't have watched or that I missed back in the day because I was a WWF kid. Or, you know, even the older stuff that's on there, like the NWA, AWA, you know, world class, that kind of stuff. It's all stuff that I never really saw because I was a fan, I got into indie stuff. The thing that really hooked me was the Gabe Sapolsky era of Ring of Honor. Well, then once that was over, I was in the business, and like you said, there's no time. And the trainer, you know, I'm not traveling with a lot of these other guys, but I am working a full-time job and holding down real life outside of it. So it's like, you know, I did miss kind of a lot of the, and now I'm kind of trying to sink my teeth back in and really go back and kind of study some stuff and watch what the trends are now and try to see where I think, you know, this business is going to be in 2 or 3 years.
Dude, absolutely. So make sure that you do whatever you got to do to watch Wrestle Kingdom. I know we're pretty excited. Joe and I and Luke Roberts were talking about it a little bit earlier. With that said, I did have one last question for you before we got into our shoot and shout segment. Here in KC, at least, and I'm not sure about PCWS, but dream job as a manager. If you can manage any guy in wrestling, because you're a damn good manager, because you do the Drew Gold thing here in town. If you can manage any guy ever, who would you manage?
Wow, man, that's a crazy question. Any guy ever. Man, I think, like, I think Heyman's got the dream gig, man. Lesnar doesn't talk. He's a super, you know, he's the guy to, you know, he's the perfect, I mean, the guy every manager would want. He has every, you know, you can pull a million different things from the guy because he's got the build, the look. He's a legit fighter. And like I said, he can't talk for himself. That's the best. This is the best, really, to feel needed as a manager. It's cool to be that guy that, like, me and Maverick have that rapport with. You know, Maverick can talk, but Maverick likes that I'm there to be the mouthpiece because you get a little guy like me next to a big, huge, hulking dude like that. He says 3 or 4 words. They're going to be much more powerful than when they come from him if I'm doing all the rest of the talk. So yeah, I mean, I think Lesnar's got the dream gig, and I always wanted to manage, you know, like this in something like a Shimmer or something like that. I always looked in the, and I always really liked cheerleader Melissa back in the.
Oh, okay, got you.
Yeah, her work, and that's a dynamic that you don't see a lot. Is like a, you know, really legit fighter woman with a male manager. It's something that's never been done, and I'm big on stuff that's never been done. So it's like, man, give me somebody like that. That would be so cool. Be the first time combo like that.
Well, you know I'm cool with Nia Jax, right? All I gotta do is call her, bro, and you're in there like swimwear. I'll make that happen for you, bro. No doubt. Well, listen, all kidding aside, we do a segment here on the show every single week. It's called the Shoot and Shout segment. You sound like a super nice guy. I mean, obviously, unless somebody messes with your client. But the Shoot and Shout segment is about 30, 45 seconds. We just get to rant, rave, and go a little bit crazy about anything that happens to be bothering us. It doesn't even have to be wrestling related. Are you down to join us for Shoot and Shout tonight, Greg?
Yeah, absolutely, man.
Let's do it. All right, Nightmare Jones, let's go ahead and get that music queued up. Let's get into Shoot and Shout, baby.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is time for the Shoot and Shout segment. I know that Rene Night Out and Greg Jovi have some great, great Shoot and Shouts. So who wants to go first?
Hey,
I'll step it up and take it, man. I'll do it.
Go ahead, brother. We're ready for you.
Well, I'm in true promoter fashion. I'm going to use it to spell the show.
Do it.
I think if I had to talk about it, something like that, it's, I've always had a little bit of a chip on my shoulders the whole time I've been promoting. I think it's what fuels me. It's what makes our product so good. Is that we've always been looked at as the number 2, number 3, number 4, whatever number you want to give us. That's what we've been looked at. Under companies like Anarchy and NWL, Dynamo, things like that, all throughout the history, there's been somebody that's been below us, been above us. And so now I want to look at 2018, and the landscape in St. Louis wrestling is insane right now. There's a lot of changes and a lot of things going crazy. So this is our time. It's time for me to use that chip on our shoulder to pedestal us to so here. We are number one. That's what we're going to do Saturday night. I don't think you're going to see a better match in the area than Pitching Vega is going to put on. I don't think people in this area draw as much emotion out as you're going to see in that main event four-way, and we have in the past. And so I think it's time to, again, I'm putting my promoter shoes on a little bit. I'm not talking anybody else down, but I'm sick of being looked at as the number two. We want to come out and look and say, hey, we are just as good as anybody else. I don't care about the number of fans in the seats. I don't care about that. But what anybody, the buzz on the internet is, all that kind of stuff, all that matters. But what matters is that what happens in that ring, and I don't care if 700 people see it or seven, we're going to be putting on the best pound-for-pound show in San Francisco.
Well, you know what? Hey, you know what, Joe? If you don't agree with Greg Jovi, well...
Fucking bullshit!
go ahead, Joe. Batter up.
Oh, my goodness. Mine is not wrestling related. Mine is about New Age rap music.
Oh,
now,
here we go.
Notorious B.I.G., Tupac, you know, Nas, that kind of stuff. And the other day, I go on to YouTube, and I'm looking up music, and there's this new rap artist by the name of New Age Joke Face. The guy has a rap video where he is wearing a wedding dress, and at one point in the video, he is on his knees with the gun in his mouth, simulating a blowjob to the gun. What the hell has happened to rap music?
No. Oh, you know what, man? You guys, I got a lot to live up to here, man. But let me give it my best shot. I'm actually with Greg. Listen, there's a lot of great wrestling in the Midwest. WWE makes their way out here all the time. If you're not making your way out to an independent wrestling show in your area and you call yourself a fan, you are not really a fan. You're not a wrestling fan. You're a WWE fan, okay? These guys, these girls that show up Saturdays, 7 p.m., at the famous Spalding Hall in Alton, Illinois, those are the guys and girls that deserve your 10, 12, 15 bucks, whatever it may be. You know why? Because they have legitimate jobs. They don't have trainers. They don't have medical staff. They've got kids. They've got wives at home. They got to drive 8, 10 hours back home just to get home that same day. They don't have a fancy tour bus. They don't have food catered in morning, day, and night. These guys, the Gary J's, the Evangelisticos, the Everett Connors, the Matt Kenways, and Danny Adams, and Vegas, and Surges, and Roses, those are the guys that deserve your hard-earned money. Ladies and gentlemen, peace, PWCS, this Saturday, the 6th, 7 p.m., that's where you need to be. Mega Ticket is going to be off the chain. You got to do whatever you got to do to go out and support independent, because that's where real wrestling happened. All your favorite wrestlers, ladies and gentlemen, Seth Rollins, Samoa Joe, Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, Daniel Bryan, they all came from promotions just like PWCS. If you're not supporting local, you are tripping, you are slacking on your mackin', and you're slipping on your pippin'. Cut it out. Stop being a slacker. Because you're going to get a lot more for 12 bucks at PWCS than you're going to get for $45 plus $30 in fees from Ticketmaster to go see SmackDown. Bottom line, cut it out. And as far as I'm concerned, if you're not going to PWCS this weekend, well, that's...
fucking bullshit!
Boom. That's my shooting shout. Greg, tell them how to follow you on social media before we get out of here, bro.
Go ahead and follow the company at PWCS Wrestling. That's the best way to get us. And then on Facebook, .com/PWCS Wrestling, or you can get links to all that on the website, www.pwcswrestling.com. That's where you can get the tickets and everything as well. Me personally, I think I'm at Custom Make Rick Jovi or something stupid on Instagram or on Twitter. I need to get a better deal. I think I'm going to blow up with this thing. But then you can also get me on Instagram, PWCS Jovi. And then we just started a little deal of our own, soundcloud.com/PWCS Wrestling, to hear us go down the history of all the events.
You got it, brother. Well, hey, we appreciate you coming on. You're officially a member now of the Wrestle Talk family. Promise us you won't be a stranger. And please break a leg this Saturday, my friend.
Absolutely, man. Anytime. Love to come back. Thank you.
Woo! All right, Nightmare, take us to break,
absolutely,
brother.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to go to break. Since it's Wrestle Kingdom, there's only one break song we can do. Only one. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you, Bossy.
Wrestling fans, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat talking at you, and you're listening to the Wrestle Talk Podcast.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. We are back. What a freaking great song. You can never go wrong with Fozzy. You know, they were actually right up the road from me, and they sold out before I was able to get tickets. I was so mad that they sold out before I was able to get tickets. Pissed me off. That should have been my shoot and shout instead of talking about rap artists.
I thought your shoot and shout was awesome, yo. I like that. That was pretty good. But listen, we got a lot of angry people. We got a lot of angry people on the line too, don't we, Nightmare?
Oh my goodness, we do. This is by far one of the angriest segments that we do. This is the Fantasy Wrestling Worldwide Chapter, or the FWWC segment, and my goodness, you're going to have people yelling at each other, you're going to have people going back and forth. I mean, there's no telling what kind of shenanigans we're going to see. I just hope that Richard Priest, if he does decide to call in, that he actually calls in and doesn't interrupt the show, but... as you and I both know, Richard Priest pretty much does whatever he wants to do.
Yeah, well, you know, that's how it happens. You know, these La Familia guys, yourself included, Nightmare, I mean, you guys kind of are feeling a little bit overprivileged, I think. You guys kind of do what you want just because, you know, you got a member of your family on the board of directors. The point is this, I can't take away anything from you guys inside the ring. And there's been a lot of stuff going on over at the FWWC. What's actually really great, Joe, is that those guys have their own podcast Monday nights, 10:30 on the Wrestle Talk Network. Basically, just visit WrestleTalkPodcast.com for more information on that. But let me tell you something, man. We got some guys on hold that are ready to come on and make a statement. And I'm pretty excited about it because before the end of this segment, we're going to find out who's in the lead, ladies and gentlemen. Because we have a brand competition, FWWC Red versus FWWC Blue, in our fantasy wrestling group. And right now, both teams, after 2 weeks, they're tied 4-4. 4 points to 4 points at the end of a four-week period of time. We're going to use those points either to sign free agents, to make trades, to compete for championships that happen to be over on the other brand. So every point matters here in the FWWC. Looks like the phone lines are blowing up. Let's have intern Timmy check on that last caller down at the bottom, 1294. Not really sure who that is. As we have intern Timmy do that, let's go ahead and bring on El Luchador of Kansas City.
Hello, everybody. How's it going tonight?
What's up, Luchador? How you doing tonight, man? What's on your mind?
Well, kind of disappointed about the last two nights. obviously given my night of Monday Night Raw, but obviously me and Kronos knocked the hell out of each other, which led up to Tuesday night, last night, last man standing match. Winner gets to go to the finals, and it didn't go the way I wanted to. But obviously, he got the advantage of me, and I went to a table and got knocked out.
Wow.
Now he's moving on, and I'm pretty much stuck in the beginner's circle again.
Well, let me say this to you, Luchador. I think you definitely brought your best. Unfortunately, when you're facing a guy like Kronos the Titan of Time, this guy is a legend in his own right. He's a former Triple Crown champ, former member of the prestigious Horsemen, and he happens to be on the line right now. I'm not sure what kind of mood he's in. Let's bring him on and see what his thoughts are after eliminating you from the competition. Kronos, you are live on the Wrestle Talk podcast with Joe and Rene on the FWWC segment, man. What's on your mind tonight?
Well, I would like to say good evening. Thank you again, once again, for allowing me to come on to your show. I'll go ahead and say this. After last night's Raw, after the brutal last man standing match we had, I was appreciative to extend my hand out to El Chidor to scoop him back up and let him walk out as legend. Because what I'm always hearing, actually from the newbies, is that do they still have it? Are they still relevant? Do they still have the ability? But then you see it. And last night we put on a showcase of our ability, of exactly what we came, what we've been doing, what we continue to do. That's the one thing I want to make sure everybody is clear on. We may stop, we may start, we may go around in circles. But when we want to put on a clinic, we will do something.
Well, no doubt about it, Kronos. That's so correct. The question is, Kronos, who are you going to be facing next? But before you answer that, let me ask Luchador this last question. Luchador, what are your plans moving forward?
Well, my plans moving forward is simple. Not only did I lose to Kronos last night, but I also had a double count out with the new rookie who calls himself Jack Hazard. If he's listening tonight, I would like to have another match with him down the road sometime before Royal Rumble week comes around.
Well, we'll see what we can do to set that up for you, Luchador. You know you got to talk to the general manager about that, but we thank you for joining us tonight. Kronos, you heard the question. What are your thoughts?
Well, I'll say this, and not to say a consolation, but I know for sure El Luchador is still in the hunt for a title, and I want to say that title is Legends Championship. And that's because a part of Team Blue, FWWC Blue Brand, we're about opportunities. You have another opportunity for a title. And I don't want you to forget that picture, because just because I moved on, I know exactly what happens next. And I tell you this, and I tell everyone, when you face me, know I have a mission, a goal, and I bring out either the best of you, the best of myself. We go all the way. You can ask Julius Cairo, because the last time we faced each other, we had the similar way. We had a tie on Raw, we finished the match and tied again on SmackDown, and then we had to do and not to spill the beans, but last minute, whoever could split up first went to the draw, and Cairo came out on the top. It doesn't stop your attention and my focus on trying to be the best that I can be in the FWWC.
Well, and there's no doubt in my mind that you continue to prove that. Kronos, we thank you for being here. And before we move on to the next caller, let me say this. The FWWC continues to prove why we are the greatest fantasy wrestling group anywhere. Many, many years ago, we started this group, and let me... Really? Really? You know what? I'm getting sick and tired of this La Familia stuff. I'm trying to sit here and run a show, and of course, who else? Richard Priest of La Familia Worldwide wants to interrupt me. I'm getting a little sick and tired of this. Richard Priest, I hope you've got something important to say tonight.
First off, night out, it's Richard Free.
That's what I said!
Second off, I have a big issue with a big man by the name of Hardcore Hawk. Apparently this man decided he can start thinks he can jump me from behind in a match and beat me to the point that I can't even make my own show Monday night, the FWBC tonight. So Hawk, if you're listening, I hope you're ready for next Monday, because you have a match with the champion, well, a non-title match with the champion, so it's time to step off, Hawk, and let's see how good you really think you are.
Nightmare Jones, Nightmare, you can hear the members of the Wrestle Talk family. Richard Priest gets no love from the fans. I know you've had your share of problems with Richard Priest. Please tell me you're hearing this nonsense.
Yes. I am definitely hearing it. I don't think that the fans may not understand exactly who Richard Priest is, but, you know...
What?
They don't matter. The fans don't matter. What matters is what Richard does in the ring, which is win. Now, Richard Priest, I do have one question for you.
You're on the Wrestle Talk podcast with Joe and Rene. Who's calling?
Hey, it's the Battle
Cat. Hey, hang tight, bro. We'll get you on.
It's about him putting you on your own milk carton.
You know, I guess it's fair. I have put AJ on the milk carton for missing a show, but I was given approved time off by the board of directors to miss Christmas night. I was out of the country. I was eating dinner with His Holiness Pope Francis in Rome. And I get put on the milk carton.
Absolutely ridiculous. Are we done with this nut-hugging that's going on here? You La Familia, guys. Listen, I'm a member of the BOD, and I got to sit across from El Mata Ratas at our meetings. And he's not even as bad as you guys. Can we move on to a legitimate caller, please? This is getting old.
Go ahead.
Oh, geez, Louise.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, it seems like the members of the Wrestle Talk family watching us live on Facebook seem to agree that you belonged on the side of the milk carton. Richard Priest, do you happen to have a closing statement? I'm sure you do.
I do. 2018 will be the year of greatness as I prove that I am greater than everybody. And if you have any questions, ask Allison Shay how great I really am.
Oh, geez, Louise. Somebody cut him off. Cut him off the line. Jeez Louise. Well, we got two more callers. We got the Battle Cat. We got Robert. We're going to try to squeeze him in here in the next 5 minutes. So hang tight there, guys. I guess we'll be leaving the best for last. But up next, a man who's not a fan of Richard Priest or Nightmare Jones, for that matter, from Jacksonville, Florida, or I should say from the heart of the jungle, ladies and gentlemen, the Battle Cat.
Hey, hello.
Welcome to the show, sir.
Oh, man, what the? It's like 32 degrees out here, so I'm feeling rather good. Not really, but, you know. But first off, I want to give Hawk some props for making Richard Priest not make the show, because we get tired, I'm sick and tired of hearing his mouth each and every week about this, about that. So it's about time somebody done something about it.
Agreed.
Yeah. And then, also, what I want to talk about next, is that, okay, last week on Tuesday, I put Jingo through a table. Send a message to Funky Bitch, right?
And oh, hey, now.
On Monday, I get put not. So, I'm laying out the challenge to Hardcore Sis. Next Monday, we're going to meet up again. It's going to be a table match. If everybody seems to like tables and stuff, bring them to the party.
All right. Dang. My question to you is, Battle Cat, you heard from at Luchador de Kansas City a little bit earlier. You know, you guys separated as the Misfits. Are you guys still on good terms, or is there a beef between you and El Luchador?
Well, I have no problem with Luchador. If I'm in a match with him because he's in my way and I have to go through him, then I'm going to go through him. But as far as that goes, I have no problem with him.
Okay, well, we appreciate it, sir. We do have one last caller to get through. Do you have a final statement?
Well, all I have to say is Monday, it's going to be Table City. Tables all over the place. And if Auden Murphy want to let his son jump the fence again, he's going to get put through another table. He's going to get put through a table.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, a man who is never afraid to speak his mind, the Battle Cat. Last but not least, folks, your current FWWC United States champion and a man who has had a lot to say recently about not getting the respect that he deserves. That's right, folks, we're talking about none other than the assassin, Robert.
What's going on, sir?
Good evening, guys. How are y'all doing tonight?
Doing great, sir. What's going on? What's on your mind?
You know, it must kind of stink knowing that you're the United States champion and yet you didn't get drafted. Like, what are your thoughts about that? Like, what's going through Rebeo's mind?
You know, it really does not really bother me as much as it used to, because like everybody was kind of two sides, and yes, it's like mandatory that you want to try to impress the GM, but you know, I've noticed that the blue brand did not even get a chance to be able to get picked by me, Mr. Corbin Slater himself. Because I was sitting there listening to the draft, and I was brought up a couple times by the red brand, Arden Murphy, but I was not brought up by the blue brand at all. So, otherwise, I'm still going to continue basically trying to fight my way to a brand. Until then, I'm just going to bring my A game every week.
Well, you know what, Robert, you continue to do that. You fight, and you really don't seem to have an issue with stepping into the ring with anybody. Obviously, right now, the guy that's really been coming after your championship is a man known as a Funky Flex. With the few moments that you have on or left in this segment, do you care to issue a message or a warning to one Funky Flex?
Funky Flex, you really think you are the thorn to my side just because you say I'm bobbing and weaving you, just pretending like I'm Mayweather, just running all over the ring and just not giving up my championship to you? But I told you, once maybe I get drafted to a brand, and if you're lucky enough, if I get drafted to your brand, I will put up my title against you. But until then, there's going to be an issue. But I'm not afraid of you. You may have a record that shows that you're better than me inside a ring, but I do have something that you do not, and that is the United States Championship.
Boom. Strong words, ladies and gentlemen. From Robert, the FWWC US champ. Listen, guys, that brings us to the end of the fantasy wrestling segment. I want to thank you guys for tuning in for that, for all the wonderful callers. Man, the phone lines absolutely went bananas during that segment, and we definitely love having you guys. Be sure to share this broadcast if you are watching live right now on our Facebook live feed, and if you're listening to the replay, be sure to share it through social media. We would really, really appreciate it. With that being said, as we get ready to bring on the Mad Dog, I'm very excited to talk to this gentleman. I've seen him in action over the last couple of years, and he's extremely talented. But before we get there, there was a couple of prayer requests that we had. One from our buddy Chris out in West Virginia. His cousin just passed away. Kind of an unfortunate situation. I mean, we all know that, you know, this is life. And sometimes people leave a little bit early. But myself and Joe like to believe that the man upstairs has a plan. God is very giving. He's very gracious. And his plan isn't necessarily for us to understand, but it's definitely for us to respect. But we do want to pray to him that that the family of Chris's cousin and Chris himself find strength in these difficult times. We also want to send a prayer request out to Larry Matisic on behalf of Jay Hollywood, SICW's very own, man who's been the voice of pro wrestling in the independent / St. Louis area for many, many, many years. He's obviously over there at SICW alongside Herb Simmons and the rest of the gang. So we want him to have a quick and speedy recovery. And then, of course, last but not least, the gentleman who usually hosts this segment, the Snippets of Truth segment, Big Daddy P, has recently had to go in for treatment. He's, you know, struggling with his blood sugar and a couple of other things. He's done so many wonderful things for the Wrestle Talk podcast, Joe, including helping us with our website. He's helped us book some of the biggest guests we've ever had, including the Masked Saint himself from the movie, Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, Mark Merrow, and the list goes on and on and on. So, Big Daddy P, we want you to know that you are in our thoughts and prayers. We love you, brother. God bless you. We hope you're okay, and we hope to have you back on the show next week. Nightmare Jones, did you have any prayer requests for tonight before we move on to our second featured guest of the evening?
Actually, tonight, I'm good. I don't have anything tonight, actually.
Hey, you know what? I learned something a while back, man. I think Big Daddy P was the one that said it. He's like, hey, if you have no prayer requests, that's a reason to rejoice. That means things are good. You know, Big Daddy P always tells us, man, the past is in the past, the future is the future, but the present is called the present because today is a gift, and if everything is okay, that means that you are blessed, so that is also a good reason to give thanks, man, no doubt about it. So, with that being said, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank everybody from the FWWC. Again, much love to those who submitted prayer requests. And Greg Javai of PWCS, who was with us at the beginning of the show, along with Luke Roberts of Dynamo Pro Wrestling, who joined us for Snippets of Truth. The one final thing that I needed to address before we got the Mad Dog on was the updated score totals for the FWWC. Everybody's been patiently waiting. I've been excited. And the shows that we had this week were absolutely tremendous. But one brand came out slightly on top of the other. So this week, the red brand was awarded 3 points for the show that they put on, and the blue brand was awarded 2 points, meaning that the red brand is now ahead by a score of 7-6. That's right. You heard it here first on the Wrestle Talk podcast. The red brand is ahead by a score of 7-6 over the blue brand, hot off the presses. Make sure that you guys get the word out to those general managers, because I'm sure they've been anxiously awaiting to hear who's coming out on top in week 3. That being said, Nightmare Jones, it is that time, the moment we've all been waiting for. Mad Dog McDowell is going to join the show. And as we introduce him, we will ask intern Timmy to kindly cue up that music, because it is a damn good song, man. I'm telling you something. A man that hails from Leesville, Louisiana, Mad Dog McDowell, has been wrestling in the Midwest for well over 10 years. Mad Dog has competed in some of the top promotions in the area, including Dynamo Pro Wrestling. Metro Pro Wrestling, Windy Pro, NWL, AAW, and most recently and most regularly with our friends over in Iowa at 3XW. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show for the very first time, the Mad Dog, McDowell. Mad Dog, welcome to the show, brother.
What's going on, guys?
Ah, man, a whole lot, not a whole bunch at the same time, man. How you been?
Not too bad. Celebrating Christmas and New Year's Eve, New Year, to do some ass kicking, you know what I mean?
No doubt about it, sir. From what we hear, you've been very, very busy kicking ass all over the place, man. Tell us, for those who are not as familiar with the Mad Dog, man, what have you been up to these last couple of months?
Well, me and John West, the reclaim the 3XW Tag Team Championship against the Bay City Bruisers. And we're doing a lot of Comic-Con, dressed up like barbarians and swinging big-ass axes and throwing everybody in their way.
Dude, that's awesome, man. We recently had Kansas City Comic Con here in Kansas City, and it was a tremendous job. I'm curious, Mad Dog, are you much of a comic book fan, or are you more of a movie comic book fan kind of guy?
Oh, a little bit of both. I got my titles every month that I pick. Don't get a whole lot of time to read anymore, but it's nice to do it when I get to.
Oh, dude, that
it's great time to be a comic guy. I mean, there's something going on every week on TV or movies, and just can't go wrong.
Dude, there's no doubt about that, Mad Dog. I'm obviously here in the studio with my partner, Nightmare Jones, and I did want to reminisce with you a little bit, man. I had the pleasure of seeing you in action a couple of years ago at one of my first independent wrestling shows at the Turner Rec in Kansas City, Kansas. As it turns out, the NWL has made the decision to start running shows back at Turner Rec Center. I'm curious, man, do you have any memories of working Turner Rec, and are you as just excited as we are that NWL is going to be making their way back there?
I think that's one of the greatest venues for independent pro wrestling that we have. I'm kind of jealous. I wish we had something like that here in Des Moines, but there's so much history in a relatively short time, about 5 years. Or just think of all the different matches that they have at Turner Rec, and it's probably the best thing for them, I think, to go back there and continue the tradition and continue to grow.
Well, yeah, I know I'm excited about it, especially because it's so close to my house. If I have one too many beers, I can just walk home.
There you go.
I definitely like that. You probably remember us, Mad Dog. We were those crazy guys that used to set up the grill outside of the building. And I want to let you know, man, if you're ever hungry before the show, man, we're going to continue doing that. So be sure to make your way out.
Oh, you know, I like to eat. So, I'm going to have to stop by.
Hey, no doubt, man. Let me ask you this. You mentioned your tag team partner, John West. You guys have been doing your thing for quite a while now. You guys have been going up and down the roads, man. How did that partnership come together initially, man? Because you guys definitely make a dynamic duo.
Well, back around that time, I was teaming up with Crotch as the Horn Dog, and Crotch got an untimely injury, and so I was left with tournament, and John was kind of a free agent there. He was was in his first or second year wrestling, and he was with a couple guys a little bit, with Bradley Charles here and there, but nothing really stuck, and me and Scott Pierce, our manager at the time, we kind of looked at John and saw a bright, athletic young kid full of spit and vinegar, and so we put us together, and it just clicked.
Oh, dude, it definitely clicked, and I remember seeing you guys working together, and the first thing that stuck out to me was your guys' size, and then your partner rocking the Black Wrestlers Matter t-shirt. I remember that. That definitely struck a chord with us. We thought that was pretty clever.
Yeah, it's enough to say we all beer, and enough to say we both all beer, as far as diversity and working together and trying to bring light some of the issues that are going on right now in America. And hopefully we set an example of how America should be.
No doubt about it. And you guys prove that every time you step in the ring. I'm curious, when you guys transitioned out of Metro and into NWL, you guys took upon another persona, different names, kind of the similar deal. Can you kind of walk us through that a little bit? Were you able to participate in that development of those new characters for the time that you guys were regularly at NWL, and how did you feel about it at the time?
We had some input. I didn't really know what to expect. So I kind of went in there with a blank sheet. I knew they wanted to have, rights to the wrestlers like this in trade and all that fun stuff.
Yeah.
And so I didn't really go in with too many ideas because I didn't know really what to expect. And that's just kind of came about in a roundabout fashion. Now we're big guys, athletic, but kind of everyday Joes type of speak, and they just kind of formatted there to kind of do a little bit of a hacksaw, Dusty Rhodes type of gimmick, and trying to reach out to Americans, the common folk, and a little bit with the diversity that we kind of personify.
Well, no doubt. Well, I definitely enjoyed seeing you guys in action during that time, and obviously it'd be great to see you guys back in town, just because I think as wrestling grows throughout the Midwest, I'd like to see Kansas City be a part of that. But I know that you guys keep pretty busy, man. Over at 3XW, you guys have been working there for a very long time. You guys have some prestige built up. You've become champions on multiple occasions. So maybe talk to us a little bit about your trek and your time over at 3XW, which is also a very successful promotion over in Iowa.
3XW is where I was trained with Brian Ash. He had trained underneath Harley Race and George Hunt Jr. I kind of graduated college, went to Des Moines, and finishing playing football and track and all that. So I was kind of a loss, not sure what to do. And I saw advertisements for 3X Wrestling, and at the time, I didn't really know a whole lot about indie wrestling either. That was kind of the beginning stages, right after Tough Enough started coming out, and people maybe got a sense of a way to get into wrestling before the internet. And really, unless you knew somebody, you had no idea how to become a pro wrestler. So I checked out their shows and saw that it was a pretty legit promotion, and went and checked them out and got trained. And I've been with them since late 2006, early 2007. And just kind of grew from there. It's a great home. I think 3X Wrestling has some of the greatest wrestlers come to the Midwest, went through nationally, and we like to give a kind of a stage to as many new people as we can and older people, and try to just make a class act show.
Well, that's awesome. Joe, why don't you jump in here? I know you had a couple of questions for the Mad Dog. This is your time, sir. Jump on in.
Absolutely. One of my first questions I wanted to ask the Mad Dog is, you are a singles wrestler. What made you want to become a professional wrestler?
I think it has been my blood my whole life. When I was 5 years old, I remember watching with my grandpa. I wanted to watch cartoons, and he turned it over to his All-Star Wrestling with Bulldogs off the ground on there, and I just fell in love with it overnight. I think if I had a way to get in sooner, I probably would have, but I got a pretty good base with athletics through high school and college and stuff, so I think that helped contribute to what I do in the ring today. But, you know, it combines athleticism and working with the crowd and the kids and all that. I don't think there's a better venue or an avenue to entertain Americans. I think it is America personified. Pro wrestling is probably the greatest thing ever put together, and it's very underrated, I believe.
Absolutely. Now, not only were you a singles wrestler, but you also have won multiple tag team championships with your partner John Rest, as you formed the American Bulldogs. Are you more of a, do you like doing singles wrestling better, or do you like doing tag team wrestling better?
You know, I just like to get in the ring and punch people right in the mouth for America.
Nice.
But they're both aspects I love, but I love tag team wrestling. That was probably, other than Hulk Hogan growing up, tag team wrestling was probably what I looked forward to most when I was watching between Road Warriors and Heart Foundation and the American Bulldogs, the British Bulldogs. And, you know, the list goes on. And tag team wrestling was very exciting to me. I think having two guys up there with a gimmick just seems like the coolest thing ever.
Okay. And my last question before I throw it back to Rene, since you enjoy tag team wrestling and you seem to be a guy that's been watching wrestling for years now, if you and your partner could go against any tag team, past or present, who would that be?
Me and John talked about this a lot. Obviously, in the past, there'd be several teams, but today, in relevant, I think us versus the Briscoes would be a hell of a match.
Wow, hell yeah.
The Briscoes, that's what I'm talking about. And just by seeing some of your matches, I would have to definitely agree that would be one heck of a match. That definitely needs to be set up and done, 100%. Rene, I'm sure you have a bunch of more questions for the Mad Dog, so the floor is yours, my friend.
I do, actually, and I'm curious about something. Mad Dog, in your career, you've done a lot of different things. You've had a lot of different successes, and you've come up short in a lot of instances. I'm curious, when you have the opportunity, when you're backstage before a show, and a promoter asks you, hey, do you want to play a bad guy? Do you want to play a good guy? Do you lean in a certain way? Do you feel like your character, your persona, lends itself a little bit more towards being a fan favorite? Or does it lend itself a little bit more maybe towards being the antagonist of the show?
Well, I lean towards the fans. I love the fans, and they're the ones that kind of give me But I do have a nasty side, and I've shown it a couple times, mostly in the Chicago area. But it can be pretty fun too, you know. But overall, I definitely lean towards the fans.
No doubt about it. And I've seen the fans react to you before, and it's definitely, it fits you guys, it suits you guys, especially with, you know, when you guys were doing the kind of the working man gimmick. I think people really took that out and enjoyed it. Wish we could have seen a little bit more of it, but that's just me personally speaking. The next thing I wanted to ask you is, you spend a lot of time in locker rooms with a lot of young guys. Are you ever approached by any of these guys who maybe are familiar with you, and maybe it's their first rodeo, second or third rodeo? What kind of advice, if any, do you try to share with these guys in terms of being successful out in front of the crowd? But more importantly, longevity, Mad Dog, because one of the things that I think people don't get enough credit for is lasting in this business, which is a very difficult business. You know, we've all heard the old saying, you know, a handshake and a hot dog. What would you advise a young guy that came up to you in the locker room as far as longevity and being successful in front of the crowd?
You know, I do get a lot of guys coming up to me. We do a lot of training at 3X Wrestling, and we're getting ready to start that again here. But normally, you know, when you're talking about 18 to 22 year old guy, I told him to get in that weight room, start getting as strong as you possibly can in your 20s, and become as athletic as you possibly can. And from there, you know, you got to have dedication. I tell them, you know, if you're going to be a pro wrestler, you're not going to be the greatest boyfriend in the world. You're not going to be the greatest girlfriend, the father, and all that stuff. I mean, when you're home, you got to do what you can to kind of make up for when you're gone. But you're gonna make a lot of sacrifices, birthdays, anniversaries, and all that stuff. And you got to put the miles in, especially in those first 2 years. You got to be willing to travel anywhere and everywhere, despite if you're going to be losing money or not. Obviously, you want to try to get together with many people, like-minded people. Kind of the best example, I think, like the hooligans. Those guys will travel anywhere and punch somebody in the face. And look how far they're going, man. They're even wrestling down in Mexico now. But you got to get with a good group and try to maximize your costs as much as possible and try to wrestle as much as possible. That's the biggest thing, is getting in that ring. And not necessarily wrestling against anybody. I mean, even if you're wrestling against somebody in the backyard or something like that, you can still learn from that. You can still learn how to reach the fans, to connect to them. But as you know, try to find as many quality opponents as possible too, because you're always going to learn better or more from them as opposed to just anybody, you know.
Well, no doubt about it, man. The only way to get better is to face better competition, which I guess leads me to my next question, man, dog. After so many years in the business, man, have you ever found yourself kind of maybe this is an overused term, but have you ever found yourself kind of marking out being in the locker room with maybe one of your heroes, or maybe even stepping in the ring with somebody that you've looked up to and you go, wow, I'm in the ring with, you know, X wrestler. You know, have you ever found yourself in that situation?
Sure, you know, I try to play it cool, but
right.
I think one of the biggest times when I meet Little Lawyer Animal and Maddog and Sean were one of two of the coolest moments, and probably one of my favorite guys I met several times and was able to ride in the car with was a Hacksaw. He had a story for days.
Hacksaw Jim Duggan, man, that's freaking awesome. That's any interesting stories that you might share from that experience, or maybe another road story you might have in your back pocket?
What's the rating of the show?
What was that?
What's the rating of the show?
Bro, hey, we're internet radio. You drop whatever you need to drop, brother. You're good with us.
Well, the best advice he told me is, like, you know, if you're going to be a pro wrestler, be a pro wrestler. And just that voice, you know, a lot of these old guys, they just knew how to reach that crowd and just keep their attention, you know. And they were just all bigger than life. But that's just, I tell all the young guys, if you really want to learn how to command that stage, watch those older guys wrestle. But he told me, it's like, Maddog, you know, things are getting weird when you're in a hotel, eating a bucket of chicken, watching football, JYD, and you got two girls in the bed with vibrators beating each other, and it's just another Sunday.
Oh my goodness. I knew you had one in your back pocket, Maddog. Oh man. Hey, that's the kind of entertainment you get here on the Wrestle Talk podcast. Jeez Louise. Crazy shit, dude. Oh, that's fair.
We picked him up by 8 in the morning and we dropped him off at 2 in the morning, and he was on the whole time. That guy is just a class act and an entertainer.
Oh, dude, that's absolutely crazy right there, man. Absolutely crazy. Well, let me ask you this. We got a couple of minutes left in the segment. You've been doing this for a long time, Maddog. You obviously, the fans are reacting to your story, so they're all having a good laugh. But what's next for you? What are you looking to accomplish? What are you looking to do next? Shout out to the Buffet Club checking us out here on the Facebook Live. But what are you looking to accomplish in 2018? Do you still have things that you're looking to kind of knock off your wrestling bucket list? And if so, what are some of those?
I'm looking to bring 3 extra wrestlings and more shows. Also, as far as a wrestler, maybe start looking towards those heavyweight titles a little bit more. while still enjoying teaming up with John and maybe teaming up with Nate Redwing as our barbarian. A lot of fun in that. Also looking into like cosplay battles as well. We had a pretty good success with the recent Comic-Con and doing that, using, like I said, using weapons and the Force and all that fun stuff. I think as the entertainment business and wrestling evolves a little bit, there's always going to be the pure wrestling, but there's also going to be opportunities for crossovers as well. And in the day of superheroes and Star Wars and all that, I think people are going to be wanting to see a little bit more live entertainment using some of those characters in some fashion.
Yeah, well, you know what? There's always something left to accomplish, and it's exciting to hear somebody that is as tenured and accomplished as yourself to still have, you know, things that you want to knock out of the park. Obviously, Red Wing, we get to see him here fairly often in Kansas City as Dakota Red Cloud. But I guess I did have one final question before we get into tonight's Wrestle Talk podcast game show challenge. After being in the business after a certain amount of time, I'm sure you've run into some things that you're seeing with the new generation that you're maybe not a huge fan of. Do you have any pet peeves, Mad Dog, some things that you see guys do that you're like, you just kind of put your hand on your face and shake your head? Is there anything like that that maybe you can bring to light that might help some potential future wrestlers that are listening to the Wrestle Talk podcast tonight?
You know, I'm kind of old school a little bit, you know, but I always try to keep an open mind to newer things. A lot more comedy spots. We've seen a lot of more out of character type of things, and it has its place, and it's definitely entertaining and stuff. But sometimes I'd like to see a little bring back a little bit more realism and a little bit truer to the sport of wrestling.
Well, one, I can understand that because, I mean, let's just be honest, and I could have done this for our Shoot and Shout segment earlier, but it's become a bit of a trend to do a lot of perverted stuff now. Guys kissing guys, guys pulling lollipops out of their drawers, and things of that sort. I'm sure that kind of thing is kind of what you're hinting at.
Well, that has its place. If you're at a bar show and you've got a bunch of adults and they're having fun or whatever, but if you're at an all-ages show, Billy Ryan's turning people over with a cock, that tends to be a little bit frowned upon. I think. Hard enough to know when to pull those moves out and when to leave them at home.
Agreed. Yeah, it's all in taste. And listen, there's grown-up time and there's kid time. But yeah, I totally agree with you, Mad Dog. There's definitely a time and place for everything. Well, that being said, Mad Dog, and I never thought I'd be saying this. I don't know. I may have one too many Miller High Lifes tonight. But I want to challenge you this evening in tonight's edition of the Wrestle Talk Podcast Game Show Challenge. Are you ready to step up and face yours truly, the Night Owl?
Bring it on, brother.
Let's do it. Nightmare Jones, you know what to do, buddy.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wrestle Talk Podcast Game Show Challenge. Tonight's competitors are the Night Owl, Rene Martinez, and Mad Dog McDowell. In a few minutes, I'm going to ask you three questions. Now, when you think you know the answer to these questions, just shout out the answer. The first person to answer two of the three questions correctly will win tonight's Game Show Challenge. Now, in honor of tonight's guest, the category is Animal House. All of the answers to tonight's Game Show Challenge will have some connection to animal nicknames. Are you ready for the first question?
No.
I think so. So wait a minute. Let me get this straight. So you're going to give clues as soon as we think we know the answer, we just shout it out, right?
Yes.
Okay, gotcha. Just want to make sure.
All right, question number one. This WWE Hall of Famer has been known as the Ringmaster,
stunning
Stone Cold Steve Austin. Steve Austin.
I heard McDowell answer that question first, so McDowell gets 1 point. Rene has 0 points.
Fine, fine.
Awesome. Oh yeah.
Time to recover.
The question two. This WWE Hall of Famer held the WWF Women's Champion for many years. After losing the championship to Wendy Richard, she won it back under the name The Fabulous Moolah would be correct. That means that Mad Dog McDowell has won the Wrestle Talk Podcast Game Show Challenge. But just for shits and giggles, let's go ahead and ask this third question and see if Mad Dog can
screwed
the night out of this competition.
Screwed.
This WWE Hall of Famer has completed in multiple WrestleMania. His feuds with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat in the WWF and Sting in WCW were all quite memorable.
Macho Man
is the master of the master of the DDT.
Oh shoot!
Jake the Snake Roberts.
Jake the Snake Roberts would be correct. McDowell has answered all three questions first.
Wait! I have a question. All right, that's fine. Listen, what does a fabulous moolah have to do with an animal? I don't understand.
She wrestled under the name the Spider Lady.
How am I supposed to know that? Come on, man. I was born in 1984. That's fine. Hit the man's music. He won fair and square. The Spider Lady? For real? Who the hell? Where did he find this tribute?
Oh, money on my mind, I can never get enough. And every time I step up in the building, everybody hands go up. And they stay there, and they say yeah.
Hey, let me say
congratulations,
something.
Congratulations, Lando.
Congratulations indeed.
And of course,
you hit the head a lot.
Yeah,
exactly.
Too many steel chairs to the head.
You know, Rene, you have your music as well, so here is your song, Rene.
Aw, man, seriously? I took that loss like a grown man, and you still want to hit the crybaby music on me? That's fine, Nightmare Jones. I know you're setting me up. That's fine. That's fine. I'm going to say... What'd you say, Joe? Sorry.
I said that is the song that we always play when you get defeated. I mean, that has become a staple of the Wrestle Talk Podcast recently.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. I will say this. I'm going to be putting in a phone call to Hardcore Sis because I think she's going to spear you, Joe, because you keep setting me up. But with that being said, that's neither here nor there. Mad Dog, all kidding aside, man, truly an honor to talk to you on the phone. When I first started going to independent shows, the second show I ever went to, you and John were there, and you guys are part of the reason that I have since then gone to well over 100 independent shows. Thank you so much for everything you do. Thank you for leaving your family on the weekends, traveling all the way to Kansas City, putting your body on the line just to entertain a couple of blue-collar guys like myself and Nightmare Jones. We truly respect you for it. And we appreciate it, brother. Thank you.
Well, thank you guys for coming out and cheering us on.
All right, you got it. One last thing, Mad Dog. Tell people how they can keep up with you on social media, my friend.
Well, you can look me up on Mad Dog McDowell on Facebook and American Bulldogs on Facebook and The Union on Facebook and also on the Twitter.
On the Twitter. All right, ladies and gentlemen, first show of 2018 is in the books. Shout out to Luke Roberts, Greg Javai, Mad Dog McDowell, the FWWC, and shout out to Larry Matisic. Big Daddy P and our boy Chris out in West Virginia, who just had his cousin pass away. We really appreciate you guys being here. We're looking forward to another tremendous show next week. I will say this, you guys. The month of January is going to be crazy. Our lineup is absolutely off the chain. We hope to just continue this this upward trajectory. The Mad Dog was fantastic. Next week, we got Jay Savage, Alex Torres, and IWR's very own Jerry Bostic. The following week, the Bully Smasher, Shannon Reed, and the Agents of Chaos. And, of course, at the end of January, we got Jason Frazier from 101 Sports in St. Louis and the heartthrob Jaden Roller. It's going to be huge because we'll close out the year with Savannah Stone and a very special representative of Glory Pro Wrestling. Mad Dog, we love you, brother. Be safe on those roads, and we can't wait to see you back in action very, very soon. Grace and peace to you and everybody else that it considers themselves a member of the Wrestle Talk family. Nightmare Jones, play something nice for him, man. Let's get on out of here tonight.
Awesome. All right, talk to you all later.
Grace and peace. Facebook Live, grace and peace to all of you. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Please share this broadcast. Make sure you check out our wonderful sponsors, including our friends over at It's Me Speaking to You and TheConspiracyFarm.com. Shout out to GWF, KCXW, NWL. Shout out to Dynamo Pro, PWCS, Glory Pro Wrestling. Everybody, we love all of y'all, man. Thank y'all for making this show possible, man. It would not be possible without every single member of the Wrestle Talk family. Night out. I'm out.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.